A sunny corner in West Wales, and the World Cup came to life. Stradipar, Llanelli, Day 2, Pool 3, Argentina against Australia. And one man on a personal mission to push back the frontiers of entertainment. David Campese, also pushing back his own world record with try number 41. The Wallabies were on their way, the Pumas their cannon fodder. Except Argentina suddenly decided they were nobody's soft touch. Arbisu with the foot, Terán with the hands, and the Pumas were scratching back. In Pool 3, little was as it seemed. A new world of rugby issued its first warning. In the World Cup, tradition and history no longer guaranteed rugby's old boys the respect of the rest. Anyone could now look vulnerable. Terán again, and a try straight from Australia's own manual. In attack, though, Australia not so suspect. With quarter of an hour left, the Pumas trailed by just 7 points. Arbisu making it 20 points to 16. In the end, the Wallabies moving clear of danger, thanks to a combination of old and new. Campese and the new star, Tim Horan. Further east in Cardiff, a greater threat to the old order had hit town. Something menacing from the southern seas was knocking at the door of fading giants. Lunchtime on a Sunday, and rumours of Western Samoans trained not on islands the size of Powys, but in the powerlands of New Zealand. But nobody in truth really knew what to expect. At first, it appeared that after all, there was nothing to worry about. But then, the ball began to stick. The game for Wales turned blue. Pressure, penalty, three nil, and more to come. First drive by Vainga, suspect. Number two by Viafali, confirmation of Samoan superiority. In the World Cup, anything was now possible. 3 days later, the sunshine surrendered and the rain came down on Pool 3. Rain is nothing new in the eastern valley of Gwent. The band shook off the drops, the town of Pontypool put up its brollies and turned out in force to see if the new wave of Pacific rugby could swamp the Beach Boys of Australia. No upsets. Australia stretched again, but still unbeaten. But Wales had beaten Argentina and were back in the frame. Royalty came to Cardiff, and the Arms Park rallied once more. Reality was rolled up. The dream to score tries and beat Australia. With hope came song. Wales going in the right direction. And then the wrong direction. Slow ball from the ruck, but still deadly. Liner, winger, overlap. Try, fullback Marty Roebuck. In the second half, courageous Welsh defence began to wilt. The Australian pack had done the hard part, and now the backs could take over. Jason Little and a left winger going walkabout on the right. No try this time, but when it came, it needed no hitch kick, no tricks. A simple gap for Slattery, standing in for Australia's injured captain, Far Jones. And even when Hooker Kearns stood in the scrum half, the result the same. Campese not one to miss out on a rout. For the first time in the World Cup, Australia in top gear. Their angles, their passing, their forward support setting new standards. Some credit then to Wales for holding out against the world's best. Credit for refusing to buckle, for continuing to try and experiment. Keeping the ball alive. for invention in midfield. For support play. Ultimately, though, credit in the red. The Wallabies had the final say, not through fancy footwork, but also passes over the shoulder from second row John Eales. Tackling by a prop, Ewan McKenzie. And tries for Tim Horan. The final try came from the quiet man at the heart of the Australian orchestration. Michael Leiner discovered that the new World Cup ball was not to his liking when it came to kicking duties. So, instead, he ran in support. And the kicker became try scorer. Australia group winners, but as for the runners-up, Pool 3 was down to the wire. The last game, Argentina and Western Samoa at Pontypridd, the base of the Rhondda Valley. Western Samoa with a win would go through. Argentina winning and scoring tries could go through. Argentina winning 3-0 and Wales would go through. Anxious looks, Argentina at first not yielding an inch. But then Timo Tagaloa decided it was time to get on the score sheet. Sardis Road, Pontypridd, on its way to the heavens and all points on Mother Earth. Argentina 12, Western Samoa 35. A double sending off, but a single passport to a quarter-final at Murrayfield. Celebration time for all, bar one. For a time, it seemed that Western Samoa would do unto Scotland as they had done unto others. But then, the dream began to fade. Tony Stanger from the wing scored a try, and then a white shark in blue waters, John Jeffrey from the flank. The Samoans made one last defiant statement about the closing standards of world rugby. But this was not to be the moment for total revolution. They ran into a northern wall of defence. Scotland began to give Peter Fatiolofa and his boys a taste of their own tackling medicine. The last grains of Pacific sand had run out. Border country earthiness now filled the hourglass. Scotland now played to the Samoan beat. Scotland 28, Western Samoa 6. All that remained was the energy for one final ritual. The Samoan adventure lasted 13 days. For others, the World Cup was all about 80 minutes. Italy and the USA were the little guys of Pool 1. Once they'd met each other, all they had to look forward to was the All Blacks and England. So the Eagles and the Azzurri staged their own private final in Yorkshire on the first Saturday of the World Cup. Not Broadway, not La Scala, but Otley was theatre enough, with the Barber of Centre fame. And then some Americana. A little bit of Williams, not Tennessee, but Mark, once of Wasps, England. The backdrop of Otley wasn't entirely what the Italians had in mind. For them, the Rugby World Cup was meant to be an opportunity to impress folk back home more used to the San Siro. But down on the stage itself, Ivan Francescato set out to join Schillaci and Viali in Italian folklore. This, Italy's day of glory. Vaccari scoring try number 3 to make it all safe. But the Americans made their contribution through captain and inspiration Kevin Swords, softening the blow of defeat. Otley's final say, though, belonged to Italy. Farewell, Otley. Hello, Twickenham. And yet, the humiliation never really happened. Italy were on the big stage at last. They celebrated by killing the ball and giving away penalties by the dozen. But just occasionally, the negative became positive. Rugby's new language, Gaetaniello. Vaccari. Barba, Dominguez. And finally, Cutita, winger Marcello, brother of prop Massimo. Twickenham, not entirely impressed with Italian tactics, waved them off to Leicester. No killing the ball here, just disbelieving glances at the scoreboard. New Zealand 31, Italy 21. Meanwhile, back at Twickenham, the USA were next up on stage. Another practice match for England. Again, it didn't all turn out quite as planned. England 37, USA 9. In Pool 2, the divisions between old and new, big and small, were more clearly defined. Scotland saw a golden pathway to the final, home advantage at Murrayfield. Japan arrived full of invention, pace, courage. But rugby is a cruel game without bulk. The line-out haunts Japan. The scrummage, though, holds no fears. And nor does distance for Takahiro Hosokawa. Even in defeat, Japan made their contribution to the World Cup. Hosokawa again. In the end, though, the Scots pulled tired defenders first this way and then that way. The tackling on Tukalo weary now. Given quick ball, Armstrong and the Scottish back row, always a handful on the blind side. And Gavin Hastings rapidly becoming the showpiece beast of a modern fullback. The backs could rehearse a move or two. Gavin's brother Scott with a simple gallop for the line. Until, that is, Eiji Kutsuki decided that perhaps he wasn't quite so weary after all. Pool 2 stretched over the water into Ireland, where the home team entered the World Cup plagued by doubts and defeats. Zimbabwe proved the perfect remedy, and Brian Robinson took full advantage. Ireland were off on their roller coaster ride through the World Cup. Zimbabwe's fairground ride mainly took them backwards. But they had a forward gear too. Dawson with the first try. And Schultz with the second. Next in Dublin, the Japanese. For a long time, they stayed within striking distance of an upset. Toshiyuki Hayashi, once of Oxford University, and now of Kobe Steel, and Woolley Scrum Caps, the scorer. Ireland kept their noses in front. Staples securing the lead. Not that Japan were finished. Yoshito Yoshida had something to say about life on the left wing. Kajihara finishing it all off. But size will have its way. Noel Mannion escaping the Scott Hastings treatment in the corner. The dive, no doubt, born of relief. Yoshida is no powerhouse, but his 10 stones, 140 pounds, take him to all the right places. On the final Monday of pool matches, international rugby returned to Belfast after 37 years away. Japan and Zimbabwe. Nothing at stake, except a desire to put on a show. Japan had all the best lines. Zimbabwe couldn't bounce them around like the others. And without the buffeting, Japan cut loose. The pecking order of Pool 2 hinged on the final game at Murrayfield, Scotland v Ireland. On paper, not a lot at stake. Even if Ireland lost, they would play their quarter-final at home in Dublin. But somebody forgot to tell the players to relax and enjoy it. The result? A passionate classic. Craig Chalmers setting Scotland off. But Ireland's own outside half not to be upstaged. Ralph Keyes, leading point scorer in the World Cup. The turning point came when passions ran too hot. Armstrong with the kick, fullback Staples with the catch. And oblivion. Tony Stanger making the fair tackle. Finlay Calder adding the stiff arm spice. Staples deciding to carry on, the heart in full working order. The rest of him wobbly. The next move, all too predictable. Armstrong again to Staples again. But this time, no catch. Just a try for Graham Shiel on his first appearance as replacement for Chalmers. If it works once, why not twice? And with two balls coming down, Staples again picking the wrong one. Scotland clear 24-15 and able to permit Gavin Hastings a rare miss. Even so, the giant fullback remaining the kicker with the best strike rate in the World Cup. So, Ireland at home to face Australia in the second quarter-final. Brave, dented Ireland against the Golden Boys. Dublin or no Dublin, it looked like trouble. Eels stretching high, the backs with room to move. And a thin green line stretched all the way across the pitch. Saved, though, by a tackle on one scrum half, by another. Finally, the pressure telling. But then, after 17 minutes, a splutter in the engine, another blow to the knee of the captain. As against Wales, the Wallabies apparently able to carry on without him. Eels playing scrum half, prop McKenzie outside half, deft skills from the big men. But now, the Irish back in the game. Keys turning smoothly now. 6-3. Under pressure, the Wallabies began to reveal a new dimension to their play. They arrived at the World Cup overflowing with attacking skills. Now, time for defence. Great smothering golden blanket of defence from touchline to touchline. Not that the Irish were put off. The second half. Left-hand corner, all important, except that is when Keyes kept it straight down the middle. Nine all. Or when Australia took time off defensive duties to go back in front. 15-9. But back to the left-hand corner. Play might start going right. But it always came back to the same place. Clark v. Campese. If the ball escaped upfield, it still came back. Campo, way ahead on points. One last chance, 6 minutes left. Ireland trailing 15 points to 12 now. Clark v. Campese. Clark the jab, Hamilton the combination, Ireland the body blow. ...18-15, Ireland ahead, Australia on the ropes. The Wallabies, their own last chance. Liner, Australia the winners. Rugby's epic over. And so, from Dublin to continental Europe, Pool 4, low-key at first, France's hopes, Serge Blanco's dream of World Cup glory off to a sticky start. But then, game two, France-Fiji. Tension. So much tension. The legend of Serge Blanco fraying at the edges. But with the return of Philippe Sella, France's ambitions soon raging legitimately once more. Didier Combrabero, immaculate conversion from the touchline. Franck Meynell, the other half of the midfield. Harmony in the centre. And the French pack crushing Fiji. No Pacific upset here in Grenoble. Jean-Baptiste Lafond of the Showbiz Racing Club with his first try. The same trio of tricolour, Meynell, Sella, Lafond. And Cambrabero, same place, same result. Half time. Fiji had come with their own hopes, but the rains had come down. France was wet. France, 6 tries, 33 points, but Fiji finally managing to win some ball and some space. A fleeting glimpse of what might have been, another Pacific dream. Also in Pool 4, Romania, also disappointing. Beaten by Canada and France, they played Fiji in Brive. And at last, inspiration from their captain, Harry Dumitrash. A massive performance by the back row forward, Romania winning 17-15 and condemning Fiji to a World Cup without a win. But Pool 4 belonged to others. Canada, the forgotten side of the World Cup, had quietly gone about their business in Bayonne and Toulouse, winning 13-3 against Fiji, 19-11 against Romania. And now they patched themselves up and prepared to take on a France now hysterical with expectation. It was a big time that threatened to overwhelm Canada. Canada offered a defiance which threw France back over the edge into folly. Canada tackled, they stole possession, and they ran hard and straight. Disrupted and frustrated, France flipped again. Another villain, Pascal Ondaatje, the Basque from Biarritz. Not that he got the better of Tynan, scrum half from a different weight category. Born into a world of hockey, ice hockey, Canada unperturbed by the brawling. Indeed, it spurred them on. Gord McKinnon, one of the stars of the World Cup, taking a short cut through the tackle of Benazee. Better still, the handling of the Canadian backs. A try for captain Mark Wyatt. Bad news for the French. Didier Combrebero forced to leave the field, out of the World Cup. His replacement, Thierry Lacroix. And instantly involved. The chip regathered. The old firm, Cella, Meynell, Lafonde. And an intruder from the left wing, Philippe Saint-André. The good, but still the niggle. At long last, France settled down, their unique style of back play lying so deep, carving up the defence. But no try, disallowed, foul play. Ondaatje again. Not that it mattered too much, 19-13 to France. Except Canada had the final say, their place in stage two of the World Cup secure. A quarter final against the All Blacks. The Canadians packed their bags, heading away from the land of wine and pâté and the culture of French rugby, north to flatter, more dreary landscapes where steel and coal are king. And there they found fields where Canadians had gone before. Flanders fields, the poppies grow, between the crosses, row on row, that mark our place, and in the sky, the larks still bravely singing fly, scarce heard amid the guns below. We are the dead. Short days ago, we lived, felt dawn, saw sunset glow, loved and were loved, and now we lie in Flanders fields. Take up our quarrel with the foe. To you from failing hands we throw the torch. Be yours to hold it high. If ye break faith with us, we die. We shall not sleep, though poppies grow in Flanders fields. Whatever the inspiration, at the start of the game on the sodden turf of the Stadium Nord in Lille, Canada rocked New Zealand. Their forwards, £10 a man heavier, held sway. But the All Blacks, the reigning world champions, have inspiration of their own. They absorbed the pressure and then took control. Second half, though, a different story. Canada storming back into the match. No danger of them winning, but Tynan's try confirmed perhaps what the All Blacks already knew and what the world was beginning to suspect. New Zealand in 1987, World Cup winners, had been on a different plane. The All Blacks of 1991 were vulnerable. Canada would not be shaken off. And they ended with another of their World Cup heroes, Al Sharon, twisting out of tackles. '29-13, Canada said adieu to the World Cup. New Zealand marched on, but all was not well. The All Blacks' defence of the World Cup had begun well enough. Day one, England, and the second half straight from the old days. Kerwin to Michael Jones. New Zealand then went around the club grounds of England and relaxed. It showed. They could get out of trouble well enough, John Timu, but a carefree New Zealand was something the world had never seen. It seemed unreal. There were success stories. Graham Batchup, the scrum half, Zinzan Brook, darling of Eden Park, Auckland, a worthy successor to Wayne Shelford at number eight. And Vainga to Ingamala, Inga the winger, with no need to perfect the more dainty skills of evasion. Italy and the States were seen off, but scrappiness still dogged the All Blacks. And then the really bad news. Suddenly, Gary Whetton, yellow with flu. No Michael Jones on Sundays, no Terry Wright. And then, when not in possession, genuine cracks in defence. Italy putting the ball high, and the All Blacks letting it bounce. Even from set play, the gaps appeared. But the All Blacks were still in the last four. A Sunday in Dublin and a meeting with their greatest rivals. Mouth-watering of all cup matches, the Wallabies and the All Blacks were to disappoint nobody. Lansdowne Road spoilt for classic matches. Classic, at least, for Australia. Campo's corner, this time in attack. The All Blacks tried to feed their own potential match winner, John Kerwin, but possession slipping from their grasp and sticking to the hands of others wearing gold. This time, a pursuit in vain. Possession evenly shared, but the All Black three quarters unable to pierce the Australian defence. No Next, the All Black forwards. Finally, the kick ahead, the only option. At least here, a little scare or two. Marty Roebuck, no Pelé with his footwork. Another attack, but Little's tackle on Crowley stopping everything stone dead. Even better, a chance for the Wallabies. Australian mistakes cleared up by Australian hands. Simon Poidevin, the veteran flanker, there first. And from such unpromising beginnings, a try of genius. This time, the pursuit not in vain. Great vision from Lima of what open spaces can offer. Greater vision still from Campese of possibilities in confined space. Great support work by Horan. Half time, Australia 13, New Zealand 0. The second half, and plan B again for Australia. The All Black assault began, the Wallabies on the defensive. Innes able to bounce off one man. But then four more arriving. Too many. Bodies to the ground. Penalty. Grant Fox. The siege continued. With an occasional breakout. Edgerton from right wing to midfield. Zinzanbrook from fair to high tackle. Despair and joy. The All Blacks, 13 points adrift again. Little throwing the ball away. And Fox with a chance to narrow the divide. Closing minutes, and still Kerwin with little chance to build up speed. Finally, Kerwin in the clear. But another pass, an inch too far. injury time, and All Black realisation that another name would be written on the Webb Ellis Cup. The ball loose, but the game sewn up. New Zealand bound only for third place, Australia bound for Twickenham at the World Cup final. The last quarter-final, a trail of fans to France. Carling & Co. came by air. Parc des Princes threw a party like only the Parc des Princes can. Music, song and laughter off the field. In direct contrast, events on the field. Time now for grim business, and if that meant peppering Blanco, then so be it. Life as a doormat was not how legends were going to be remembered. The only problem, using Nigel Heslop as a punch bag, not great for reputations either. The bishop and the judge, New Zealanders keeping European cousins apart. The verdict, Anglo-Saxon penalty. France soon in more trouble, Marc Cessillon taking out Mike Teague. The presidents, Mitterrand, Ferras, not happy men. Inspector Ackford at the line-out. Guscott modelling the perfect break. And flying officer Underwood. Sweet landing. Appreciated by Moore, but not by Ondarts. France needing something special. Captain of England, lying in wait for the captain of France. Ten-six at half time. Trouble. two unlikely characters, a meter behind the ball, Seller striking Andrew. Mick Skinner, and perhaps the tackle of the tournament.
Down.
Brian Moore, the look says it all.
Get out of it.
Then Pascal Ondarts, and the French farce. Not funny, just absurd.
Get out of it!
Amazingly, France not only survived their indiscretions, they threatened to alter the whole balance of the match. Try number six for Jean-Baptiste Lafond in the World Cup, making him top of the list with David Campese.
Right.
Scores level now. Surely England's game was up. But this was the moment when England built a giant monument to themselves. Not pretty. A giant slab of reinforced concrete with foundations of French folly.
You are not even going for the man! Don't!
It can only be one man, Ondarts.
Back! My fault! Back! Serge, number three, dived in, not even going for the ball at all. Dived over the top of the other players, okay? Tell him to call it. Tell him to call it. He is in dangerous grounds. Okay? Thank you.
Webb's penalty, 13-10 to England. To pull ahead again, an outstanding achievement. Score another try, a magnificent tribute to self-control and power.
Try to call him.
Webb with the final chisel on England's sculpture. England, Grand Slam winners, and now World Cup semi-finalists. And so the trains turned round and headed northwards to Edinburgh. half-time and the game in the balance, 6-3 to Scotland. Andrew Gathering, and the hardest of England's hard men, Mike Teague on the charge, Gloucester Poetry. Another change of direction. And another. Skinner's hands. Geordie blank verse. England in control, but still 3 points adrift. Forward approval. More control, more power, and at last, the reward. Once again, a shift in the balance of power. Scotland revitalised. And then, the great miss of the World Cup. Gavin Hastings, great player, great tournament, chance lost. And from one end to the other. And now for Rob Andrew, his one golden opportunity. In injury time, Scotland with one last chance at the impossible. All in vain. England's monumental rugby standing proud and tall. They were going home to the dear turf of Twickenham.
dance the swing. Could catch it all night long. But when I'm riding on that wing, just for you, I'm in your swing.
England had reached the final the hard way. France away, Scotland away. Their strengths, giant pack, pinpoint kicking. How would they play in the final? At first, it seemed by sticking to the tried and tested. But then, the total about face. England keeping everything in the hand. Australia, the great handlers, now doing all the kicking. No score. England back in their own 22, and Australia suddenly changing the tactics. Still, no score, no penetration of the great Australian defence. And then a few English mistakes. Carling's kick. Webb's dropped catch. Suddenly, England under pressure. Skinner to the rescue. Michael Leiner still having problems with that World Cup ball. Nil all, and England's forward supreme. Bill de Teague at the heart of the construction. But behind, the first signs of trouble. The foundation solid, but the joinery lacking. Australia solid in defence, and then in attack, a chance to start the gold rush. Still nil all. To break the deadlock, something special needed. Perhaps the old double act, Horan and Campisi. But the pair denied their chance to tango by John Webb. Soon though, Leiner the first to mark England's card. 3 points and on a roll. Not the golden back division, the precious metal in the hands of the front row diggers. Ngawe claiming with two hands, and then the drive. Mackenzie, Kearns. And finally, Daly. England persisting with their new tactics. Looking for Rory Underwood, 50 times an England player, affected by the pressure and the presence of the man opposite him. Webb too, feeling the strain. Half time, Australia 9 points clear. Start of the second half, England with a new ploy, splitting the forwards. Not very successful. The game was soon to find its own true rhythm. England's labour in vain. Hope at last for England. But almost immediately, the compliment returned. Nearing the end of the two sides' sixth game in just a month, the pace only increasing. Campese, controversial to the end. Deliberate knock-on, penalty try. No, just the 3 points. And for the first time in the second half, the ball being passed Campese's way. And Campo very nearly blew it. One of his less visionary passes. Andrew Clear, with a try-saving tackle from Eales. And then England's forwards bleaching the yellow blanket. More tackling from the front five forwards, total rugby. The captain on one last dash from the front. Help from another officer, Wade Dooley, but even the Blackpool Tower brought down. The closing seconds. And Liner choosing the furthest point from Australia's line. Rugby's second World Cup at an end. Australia, the champions. For England, despair. Nobody loves a loser, they would claim. A false notion. England's was a massive contribution to rugby's global explosion. Heroic failure, heroic victory. The Gold Rush, a tribute to a great side. Australia.